Good morning. Welcome to St. John Lutheran Church on this third Sunday after Pentecost. It is good to be with you in God's house. Just a couple of announcements before we get started. Of course, I am leading a Bible study following the service at 10 a.m. in the music room on angels and demons. So if you're interested, you're more than welcome to join us. Also, you may see we have a banner. This banner comes from the LWML convention that was a couple weeks ago. And so we are blessed to have this banner with us in worship today. Our service for today is Divine Service Setting 1, but before we begin with our opening hymn, let us greet one another in the name of Christ. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your presence and eternal punishment. For the sake Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We chant responsibly the introit. Show us your steadfast love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. His salvation is near to those who fear him, that glory may dwell in our land. Righteousness will go before him and make his footsteps away.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the
your steadfast love, O Lord, and grant us your salvation. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Amen.
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
We praise you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Lord of all power and might, author and giver of all good things, graft into our hearts the love of your name and nourish us with all goodness, that we may love and serve our neighbor. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Our Old Testament reading for today is from 1 Kings chapter 19. Behold, the word of the Lord came to Elijah, and he said to him, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away." And he said, "Go out and stand on the mount before the Lord." And behold, the Lord passed by, and a great and strong wind tore the mountains and broke in pieces the rocks before the Lord. But the Lord was not in the wind. And after the wind, an earthquake. But the Lord was not in the earthquake. And after the earthquake, a fire. But the Lord was not in the fire. And after the fire, the sound of a low whisper. And when Elijah heard it, he wrapped his face in his cloak and went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. And behold, there came a voice to him and said, "What are you doing here, Elijah?" He said, "I have been very jealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, for the people of Israel have forsaken your covenant, thrown down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword. And I, even I only, am left, and they seek my life to take it away." And the Lord said to him, "Go, return on your way to the wilderness of Damascus. And when you arrive, you shall anoint Hazael to be king over Syria, and Jehu the son of Nimshi you shall anoint to be king over Israel, and Elisha the son of Shaphat of Abel-Meholah you shall anoint to be prophet in your place. And the one who escapes from the sword of Hazael shall Jehu put to death, and the one who escapes from the sword of Jehu shall Elisha put to death. Yet I will leave 7,000 in Israel, all the knees that have not bowed to Baal, and every mouth that has not kissed him." So he departed from there and found Elisha, the son of Shaphat, who was plowing with 12 yoke of oxen in front of him, and he was with the 12th. Elijah passed by him and cast his cloak upon him. And he left the oxen and ran after Elijah and said, "Let me kiss my father and my mother, and then I will follow you." And he said to him, "Go back again, for what have I done to you?" And he returned from following him and took the yoke of oxen and sacrificed them, and boiled their flesh with the yokes of the oxen, and gave it to the people, and they ate. Then he arose and went after Elijah and assisted him. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle reading is from Galatians chapter 5. For freedom Christ has set us free. Stand firm, therefore, and do not submit again to a yoke of slavery. For you were called to freedom, brothers, only do not use your freedom as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word: you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you are not consumed by one another. But I say, walk by the Spirit, and you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. For the desires of the flesh are against the Spirit, and the desires of the Spirit are against the flesh. For these are opposed to each other, to keep you from doing the things you want to do. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. Now the works of the flesh are evident: sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, divisions, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like these. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. And those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk by the Spirit. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 9th chapter. When the days drew near for Jesus to be taken up, he set his face to go to Jerusalem. And he sent messengers ahead of him, who went and entered a village of the Samaritans, to make preparations for him. But the people did not receive him, because his face was set toward Jerusalem. And when his disciples James and John saw it, they said, "Lord, do you want us to tell fire to come down from heaven and consume them?" But he turned and rebuked them, and they went on to another village. As they were going along the road, someone said to him, "I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." To another he said, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." And Jesus said to him, "Leave the dead to bury their own dead, but as for you, go and proclaim the kingdom of God." Yet another said, "I will follow you, Lord, but let me first say farewell to those in my home." Jesus said to him, "No one who puts his hand to the plow and looks back is fit for the kingdom of God." This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated for our sermon here.
O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. The sermon text, and we're preaching through this green season, is from our gospel lesson, Luke 9, starting at verse 51. Luke 9:51 is a turning point in Luke's gospel. Up until Luke 9:50, we get to know more about who Jesus is and get to see that, at least with respect to the fact that he brings the reign of heaven near. He does miracles. He casts out demons. You can hear more about that at 10 o'clock with Pastor Luke. He heals the sick. He brings the reign of heaven near. He casts out evil. But starting at Luke 9:51, Luke says that Jesus, well, when the days came near for him to be taken up to Jerusalem, and it's not just that he was going up in elevation, that to be taken up means that he would be, as St. John would say, lifted up on a cross. To be taken up would be also, as we confess in the words of the Apostles' Creed, that he was raised from the dead on the third day. To be taken up at the end of Luke's gospel, at the beginning of Acts, is that he is ascended into heaven, that he is reigning right now. That all has to do with Jesus being taken up, but Luke says that he sets his face toward Jerusalem, that he is resolved, and that there's no looking back. And along the way, it's a travel narrative broadly, and on this journey that does have a destination, which is the cross, which ultimately is the open tomb, along the way, Jesus is going to meet many different people. And some will be delighted that he has come into their life. Others will be befuddled and maybe frustrated, and others maybe just simply indifferent. But I really, and I guess this is true of pretty much every sermon text, because I get excited about a lot of things, anything and everything, right, Drew? Except for the stuff you want me to get excited about, probably. I love this text, and I think it's not an accident. We have this lectionary series where texts are appointed for a three-year series, and the way that they line up seems to be most of the time very timely with for us. On June 26th, the year of our Lord, 2022. So Jesus, in Luke 9, is coming. He set his face to go toward Jerusalem. He is going to, it is a cosmic struggle, he is going to confront evil. And it will appear for a moment, that he will be defeated by evil. Seemingly so. But that's not the way that this story ends. And Jesus, he sets his face to go toward Jerusalem, and maybe he hardens his face on the one hand. He is resolved. There's no looking back. And he sends, it says in verse 52, messengers ahead of him to go into Samaria, a village of the Samaritans. And they're to make preparations for Jesus. And we remember, we hear about the Samaritans quite often. I mean, they are related to the Jewish people, but familiarity breeds contempt. There's a lot of animosity between them. We get also a little bit of a preview for next week that Jesus is going to send out then 72 ahead of him to proclaim and bring the reign of heaven near. They will do the things he's authorized them to do, like confronting evil, like casting out demons, like healing the sick. And so he sends people ahead of him to make preparations. But then St. Luke records in verse 53 that the Samaritans, the people there, did not receive Jesus. And he tells us why. Because his face was set toward Jerusalem. They didn't receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem? Well, I think, and some other biblical scholars have noted, that part of this may be they didn't receive him because his face was set toward Jerusalem, because all many of those miracles and those mighty works that Jesus had done, and many of them no doubt had heard about, he wasn't going to do them. And so maybe it was the mother and father who, in an act of goodwill, not goodwill, in an act of faith, in some sense, would bring their child who's paralyzed or lame and say, Jesus, heal her so that she can walk again, so that she can dance with delight. And Jesus had set his face toward Jerusalem. But maybe to some people, hey, we've heard about this Jesus. He's a fun guy. He's the guy. We heard about him in Cana, turned water into wine, and that wine was way better than the wine that they introduced at the beginning. If we can get him to do that, that would be pretty cool. And he would have none of it because he had set his face toward Jerusalem. And they probably thought, well, I don't know that anything really good can come from Nazareth or Galilee anyway, and those Jews, yeah, I knew that he would let us down. And no sooner had they done that and they did not receive him, but then James and John, who St. Mark will give them a nickname, Boanerges, which means the sons of thunder, which is a pretty cool nickname. And they're probably people who are geared up. If there was going to be an opportunity for a thunder dome, they would go. And it says in verse 54, when Jesus' disciples, and look, these are two of his closest buddies, James and John, so close that they feel comfortable enough to fall asleep when Jesus is at the Garden of Gethsemane, along with Peter. They have been there. They went up the Mount of Transfiguration. Here they are, and they are offended on Jesus' behalf. And they cannot believe that these no good Samaritans would not receive. That was not the correct reaction. This is Jesus. Jesus, the one who can do cool things, and you didn't receive him. And so they say, Jesus, Lord, do you want us, and this could be cool, do you want us to tell fire to come down from heaven and consume them? And I bet they have got a hair trigger anyway. Like, they know. They've seen what Jesus can do. They have been authorized, and they're going to be authorized to do things, and this is the opportunity that they are justified. In their minds, this is righteous anger. These people, as if they needed another reason, now they have it. Let's burn them up, and we can be a part of it, and Jesus will give us the thumbs up. And that is not what happens. Instead, it says Jesus turned. And I don't know if he turned toward them or if he turned his back to them, but he turned, he goes in the opposite way, and he rebukes them. No, this is not the way. Who do we identify with in the text? I mean, that's part of the beauty of a story, of a narrative, a true story here. Well, I don't know. I mean, I'd like to identify with Jesus, but I fall pretty short. I don't know that any of us as Christ followers, like the Samaritans, rebuke him, so probably none of us here say, yeah, I'd identify with the Samaritans. But James and John, I can get behind them. And after all, this is St. John Lutheran Church. So James and John, they're not off, right? They're not wrong here. I mean, they should expect that the one who ultimately is King of Kings, Lord of Lords, who can do many mighty works, who is the Son of God the Father, who has redeemed his people with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm, who has cleansed the land from people who have defiled it, that it is reasonable to expect. They know that the prophet Elijah, who called down fire from heaven to consume the prophets of Baal and other things, that this one can, that he can do this. And John, and next week, you will hear when Jesus, before he sends out or alongside sending out the 72, he says, woe to you, Chorazin and Bethsaida and Capernaum, all those areas where Jesus had been doing mighty works and miracles. He says, if the people of the Old Testament times, and he wouldn't have said Old Testament, but the people in Tyre and Sidon had seen these sort of things, they would have repented on the spot and worn sackcloth and ashes, but you didn't do anything. You're going to be burned up. Like, James and John are not wrong in that Jesus is the one who is the judge, and he will come. God says, vengeance is mine, but not here and not now. But I identify with James and John, and like, this is a refrain each week. As much as things change, they stay the same. For James and John, there is no middle ground, right? Jesus, we are offended on your behalf. These no good Samaritans, I mean, and let's face it, as if we needed another reason to despise them, let's burn them up. Burn it down. night of rage, day of rage, burn it down to the ground. Well, we live in a time, a time where we yearn for the King to return. Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest. That the temptation is to believe there is no middle ground. And again, to be fair to James and John, even though life isn't fair, ultimately, there is going to be a separation. Either you're following Jesus or not. Ultimately, we know that on the day of judgment, there are going to be those, and you guys are fortunate today, who are at the right hand of Jesus, who are the sheep. You're on the right side of the aisle. And you, I'm sorry, are on the wrong side of the aisle. You were the goats. You're still, no, it's too late. It's too late. The door is shut, Randy. Sorry. But I'm glad you were listening. It's too late. There is a time that's coming where either you're in or you're out. Jesus, you confess him as Lord and Savior, or you don't. That is an ultimate truth. But we live in a time, and we live in a time where there seems to be no middle ground either. And look, we see this. I mean, I didn't bring my phone up here with me. I guess I should have. Just open up your anti-social media and look at the responses in the last 36 hours to stuff. And it is, hey, look, just, I guess this is it. Burn it down. Burn it all down. See, James and John, they believe that Jesus is Lord. They know and they trust that he does have the power to bring down fire from heaven. However, it's not their role to bring the fire, to bring the noise, to bring the vengeance. It's Jesus' role. Or said another way, judgment, just like grace, which is a gift given by the Holy Spirit, which hears and clings and sees Jesus as Lord and Savior, is always on God's terms. It's always on God's terms. It's a first commandment issue. You shall have no other gods. It's a first article issue. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, which means that you and I are not God. Right? That's what Professor Dr. Okamoto would say. God is God. You are not. Neither am I. Said another way, know your role. Right? Jesus is Lord. You and I are not. We're called to follow him, not to tell him what to do. And so on the one hand, look, James and John assume, I think, that they know what Jesus needs. We are offended on your behalf, Jesus. Hey, we'll help you out. We'll call down fire from heaven. Burn it down. But Jesus instead, he says, listen and watch. This is what I want. And he rebukes them. He says, follow me. And that takes courage to follow Jesus. See, it's James and John, I think, in their love for the truth and for the one who is the truth and the way and the life, they long for God to make it all right now. But not yet. It's not time. And the other thing that I think is always going to be true, and we realize this as we live by faith, is we say, look, we have been baptized into Christ, that we are the body of Christ, and so then because we are Christ, we are to be little Christ to other people. This is what comes out in the epistle lesson for freedom, that Christ has set us free, and stand firm and don't submit again to a yoke of slavery. And maybe it's the slavery to your position or a position against somebody else. And in the end, it's also to realize that other people, I believe this to be true, other people are not the enemy, not ultimate. It takes faith to believe that. But other people, I'm saying this to myself and you as well, are not the enemy. There is an enemy, and he is evil. But other people are not the enemy. And I see, this is the thing that's been on my heart and mind just the last few days, and it's not a new thing, but it's interesting to see what triggers it in people. that somehow this is the thing that will sever all relationships. Now, our guiding statement, and it is scriptural, it is biblical, is cultivating Christ's community. Cultivating Christ's community. And so it is heartbreaking to me to not see as much but hear about, because I've had to not see it, that on something like Facebook, and maybe you've seen this, and Lord have mercy, if you've put this out there, I would think that maybe there's a deeper conversation to be had. But people will say, will write things just in the last few days, and I want to, there's no nuance in this statement. I do not believe there is a middle ground when it comes to the sanctity of life. I do not believe any Christian in good conscience can say there's a middle ground. I don't believe that. It is heartbreaking to me to see that people, and regardless of which side of the aisle they're on, the right side or the left side here in church, or let's face it, everything's political aisle, they would say things like, look, whatever your reaction is to the latest Supreme Court decision, if it is different than mine, go ahead and just unfriend me now on Facebook. Now, look, I'll tell you, Facebook I don't think is real life. Because the only thing lacking from Facebook is a face-to-face interaction. And it's really easy to look into the dead eye of Sauron on your phone or computer and type out whatever. And it is heartbreaking to hear about people say, look, if your position is you're glad about this, we're no longer friends. And maybe, just maybe, other people said, well, if your position is that you're not glad about this, we are never to talk to one another again. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Andrea shared with me about some of our neighbors that had posted something similar. And we like our neighbors. We love our neighbors. And I had said, because I am given to do this, that it was essentially, because our position is different from their position. We've just not published this on Facebook because I don't think it's the real world. I said, well, I wonder if we just went over, though, and said, knocked on the door, hey, we're really sorry that we can no longer be friends anymore and neighbors. That's a real shame. We loved you, so bye. See, I don't think to turn and look someone in the eye that any normal person would do that. And that's not the way. See, Jesus says, and St. Paul says, and it's fitting, so we are set free in Christ, and we are set free from sin and death and the power of the devil. And then Luther would say, and I would agree with this, that we are set free for loving our neighbor. And do not use your freedom, St. Paul says, as an opportunity for the flesh to fire off whatever you want to fire off on Facebook, and that may be the least of our concerns, but through love, serve one another. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, watch out that you're not consumed by one another. And that's not much of a way to cultivate any kind of community. That's to ultimately have a community of one. I thought about it last night. Somebody had a black and gold shirt on, and I thought I should just post on Facebook, if you cannot get yourself behind the Purdue Boilermakers, just go ahead and unfriend me now, right? You know, and by the way, if you're not a person who likes the morning and I like the morning, go ahead and unfriend me now. Well, that's stupid. I don't know another way to say it. Stupid. So, maybe, just maybe, because we're set free in Christ, and Paul talks about it this way, walk in the Spirit. That's what disciples do. They follow Jesus. And you will not gratify the desires of the flesh. And he lists off this vice list, and some of them in there, we'll get past the idolatry and sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, and divisions, just to name a few. I warn you, as I warned you before, that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. And here are James and John that say, hey, Jesus, can we burn it down? No. No. Because Jesus, and there's a textual variant that adds on to part of verse 55 and some of the early manuscripts in the Greek, that Jesus says, he turns and rebukes them, and he says to James and John, you don't know what kind of spirit you have or are of. The Son of Man didn't come to destroy people's lives, but to save them. To save them. To seek and save the lost. And it's sure hard to save somebody when you burn them down to the ground. And they in turn maybe want to burn you down too. Maybe there is a better way. And St. Paul says, the fruit of the Spirit is love, and joy, and peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. And maybe sometimes that self-control is to do something. You sent me and Pastor Luke, I think, yesterday, Noah Schrader, an image of you. You were doing something under your deck, and you had some boards out, and you literally had your head below the boards in your deck. And maybe that was just to avoid exposing yourself to social media. Now, that's an extreme move. Do you still have those deck boards out? Okay, well, I was going to say, if maybe some other people need that therapy, go to Noah's house and put your head under the deck. Follow Jesus. See, we're free. And that freedom is not is an opportunity for the flesh to just do whatever I want because I have my rights. But you're free to love people who would otherwise seem unlovable. Because the truth is, that's what Christ has done for you and me and continues to do. And so whether, you know, the Samaritans don't have the correct response, they reject Jesus, but apparently James and John don't either. The idea to burn it down. Because in the end, judgment and vengeance are not yours or mine. They're the Lord's. Jesus is the one who sets his face to go toward Jerusalem, and ultimately when he sets his face to go toward Jerusalem, it is not to, in the near term, to mete out judgment and vengeance, it is to take it into himself. The judgment and vengeance that you would intend for other people, he's taking it into himself. The judgment and vengeance that other people, let's say, let's just put the best construction on it, foolishly, because they don't actually know what they're doing, and maybe if it came down to a real face-to-face conversation, they don't mean it. But it will take patience. It will take kindness. It will take gentleness to actually, it'll take courage to say, hey, does he really mean that? And I think that's the way that community is built, and courage is lived out, and maybe there is compassionate action rather than, I don't think you can say anything is compassionate about burning other people down. But we are always called to turn toward the face of Jesus, who turns toward you and me. He turns toward us, and sometimes it is to say, what in the world are you doing? Stop. It's to turn toward him and to know as he turns toward us. And maybe you say, I don't know. Lord, have mercy. And he does. And not only can we look into his face and we know that one day we will, just with Job, as we know that our Redeemer lives, but we can look into his face and his eyes that maybe melt with compassion for us, but we, along with Thomas, look at his hands. And his feet, and his side, as he has taken that poison, that vengeance, that judgment into himself. That we can look full at Jesus and see that he sees us. But he doesn't only see you and me. He sees those Samaritans who didn't receive him. He sees your neighbor who fires off, let's say, immature things on Facebook. Maybe you just better stay off Facebook and put your head below Noah's deck. But not forever. Hard to move if you got your head below your deck. But he not only sees you and me, he sees our neighbors. And if we live by the Spirit, we also walk by the Spirit. It's here in the church, it's about cultivating Christ's community, and it takes courage to follow Jesus wherever he goes. And we'll be tempted to try to put conditions on it, or maybe we don't count the cost. He wants everything. But he says to follow me. And to follow him, it is an adventure, because it is to let him lead. It is to go to places that we would have never guessed but to trust that ultimately it is for our good, because he never is going to lead us to a place that would result in further misery and darkness and death and being cut off, but it is a place that leads to life and light and to have joy and to have it fully. That's what it means to follow Jesus, to know that he is the one who has come not to destroy people's lives, but to seek and save the lost. And he's done that for you and me, as well as our neighbors, whom we're free to love. To Christ be the glory. Amen. And now may the peace that passes understanding guard and keep our hearts and minds in Jesus, our Lord and Savior. Amen. And this time I invite you to stand as we join together and confess our shared Christian faith through the Apostles' Creed.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered. Let us pray for the whole Church of God and for all people according to their needs. God of our salvation, when your Son set his face to go to Jerusalem and the cross, his zeal would not be deterred. Grant us to pray with the same fervor and boldness, trusting that you hear us for the sake of the Son of Man. Lord, in your mercy, God of the Church, we thank and praise you that you give life in your Church. And we rejoice especially on this day at the baptism of Emily Lowe yesterday. And Lord, you give pastors and church workers to proclaim your steadfast love, to announce freedom from the yoke of slavery to sin, and to point all toward the cross of Christ. Bless their faithful work, that their labor in the Lord may never be in vain. And we especially lift up to you Reverend Stuckwish, as he has been elected our district president of the Indiana District. Lord, in your mercy, God of compassion, you establish the family to be a place of protection and growth. Grant that our homes would never become a stumbling block to the kingdom of God, but that they would serve to foster within us the fruit of the Spirit. Lord, in your mercy, and God of all power and might, to you belong the kingdom and the glory forever. Give insight and wisdom to our president, governor, legislature, and all government officials. And we solemnly thank and praise you for the judgment of the court this week in reversing decisions that have given open sanction to the destruction of human life. Curb wickedness in every heart and place. For the sake of Christ, spare us those punishments that we have all deserved. Restore compassion and the desire for life among all, and lead your church to show your love to the vulnerable, to the despised, and to those whose hearts have turned cold. Your Son has taken up our fragile flesh to free us from the bonds of sin by his death. Draw every heart to yourself, Holy Father, that believing in Christ, we should not perish but have everlasting life. And lead us, your people, to be people of your peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear
our prayer. God of refuge, your salvation draws near to all who trust in you. Grant peace to your people and show us your salvation. Hear our petitions for healing, strength, and comfort for all whom we name in our hearts and whom we lift up to you on our prayer list. Be near them as the refuge of the weary and the God who preserves his people. Lord, in your mercy, God of our Lord Jesus Christ, grant that the whole church might fix her eyes on him. Teach us the way of the cross. Remove hindrances and distractions. Do not let the freedom we have in the gospel become an excuse for sin and vice, but an opportunity for love and service. Lord, in your mercy, into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. You may be seated. This time we continue worship by gathering our tithes and offerings. We also welcome you to St. John's Day and ask you to fill out the attendance cards and place those cards in the offering plate. Please rise. Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created, and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood, as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into
Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you, this do in remembrance of me." The same way also he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Thank you.
That you, body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen and preserve you both in body and soul today and to life everlasting. Depart in his joy and peace. Amen. Please rise. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith towards you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace.